I feel like a lot of founders, especially in the tech ecosystem, are dealing with PTSD because of this fundraising thing. Imagine like being rejected over and over and over again. You have to be mentally prepared, physically prepared, ready for the no's, which is the difficult bit to handle. My name is Tola Adesanmi. This is my young CEO story. So Spleet is a company that provides decentralized housing, decentralized rental, and access to housing. So typically our members are business professionals. They are young families that want to pay their rent or their subscriptions monthly and quarterly. This literally started because Dolapo, my co-founder, was couch surfing. He had moved back from the UK and he just found it absurd to pay 1 year or 2 years rent upfront. He didn't have the money, right? And statistically, we find that 76% of the people that rent today borrow their first rent, right? And about 50-something percent of those people stay stuck in that cycle where they are borrowing 1 year's rent because they don't earn annually, right? It's one of the reasons why people feel like they need to get a second hustle, third hustle. Whereas there could be a system, which is what we've provided today, that you can pay monthly, pay as you earn, right? Or pay as flexible as you want. And minimum of a month. I think succeeding at that to an extent and the goals of, you know, multiplying that effect of the success and the product market fit is what sort of drives me to do this every day. It's difficult fundraising because you sort of meet different people wanting to invest for different reasons. And I typically enjoy, even if it ends up in being a declined, you know, response, I like when VCs or angel investors sort of make decisions fast, right? That works for me because I know to move on. But again, I mean, fundraising is a journey, right? It's not something that you just go into, right? You have to be mentally prepared, physically prepared, ready for the no's, which is the difficult bit. I have this thing that I say that I feel like a lot of founders, especially in the tech ecosystem, are dealing with PTSD because of this fundraising thing. Imagine like being rejected over and over and over again. That's typically a very, very difficult thing to handle. Like I have like a sheet of over like 100 investors that we've spoken to, and you know, about 70 of them we're still speaking with. And I'm part of the lucky ones who has gone through like a pre-seed round and then gone to a seed round. I'm doing a seed round. Most companies die before they can raise a dime. But I think the persistence is key. Waking up every morning, preparing to pitch the same thing over and over again, and the willingness to learn is important. Because our goal, you know, our North Star, which is essentially like providing easier living for everybody in Africa, as easy or as accessible that living can be, you know, sort of brings us to work every day, brings me to work every day to do this over and over and over and over again, regardless of the rejection. I mean, we have the wins. We closed an investor like 2 weeks ago. That was a big win after like a long due diligence process.
We're
an 18-man team. And when we started the business in 2018, I think something that was very core for us was to build a team that was very high-powered, but still felt easy, right? Calm team. And in building the team, I think people don't talk about this often. They always try to seem like it's an easy thing. We've made mistakes along the way, right? And understanding, in trying to understand what type of team we wanted to build. In the beginning, we thought that we're building, you know, the typical tech team that would say, oh, we're family here, right? But we had to like re-evaluate that, right? Because our values, even though you would find them in the family, we still want to work hard, right? There's no space for you know, laziness with how we work. We try to work smart. So you find people sort of trying to even learn each other's work. And not because they're gonna do it, but because they want to know how it ties into their own work. So growth, sort of understanding what business development is doing and how they can help with that. I think one of the things that we are very core about is empathy. Because, you know, providing living spaces, especially if they're co-shared or entire spaces, requires a level of empathy, right? It's not like co-working spaces where people just want power, they want to work and go home. They're going, when they leave the co-working space, they're coming to us, who would typically give them somewhere to rest. So everything has to be intact, right? And that's how we sort of deal with one another, right? If someone's dropping the ball, you want to help as opposed to admonish, right? I mean, we have systems to sort of keep people in check and keep people accountable, but empathy is very core in how we work with one another. We have these 6 weeks, because now we're working remotely, so most of the guys are not in the office. We have the 6 weeks stand-up that we do, which is separate from the daily stand-ups that we do remotely. Everybody comes into the office, sort of talks about their problems, what's not fitting for them. We also like are building like a community, and this community starts with us, right? Us being a community ourselves, and then sort of bringing into that community our members, right? And one of the ways we've sort of done that is, even though we've put a cap on it, we sort of invite our members to come and work in the space. Hey, Victor, how far? Yes, and we get to dress how comfortable we feel. There's no cap on how to dress or what to wear. Sexy Victor in shorts. Yeah, I mean, like, we're dressed down. We're as comfortable as we feel. We have an open door policy here as well. Everybody can speak. I'm not Sir or Mr. I'm Tola, simply Tola. Like, we're all on first name basis. And this is Victor, head of growth. Spleet is changing our lives, right? It's changing our lives, we that are building it, and it's changing the lives of the people that we are offering services to. Because halfway through building, we sort of found out that we had a high percentage of women in our spaces, for instance. And culturally, digging down into what that problem was, we found out that culturally, there were traditional ways landlords would rent to people that didn't include single women in Nigeria, right? And that's a cultural problem. And because our platform and our services, you know, removes that bias, we're changing lives of women, right? Women can rent a place today without any bias. And essentially, all they really need to provide is, you know, documentation to say, to tell us that they are who they are, and we can verify that documentation, and we can find, you know, verify the fact that they can afford the space they are booking. Every other thing that sort of ties into it is not, that would happen traditionally, is not, that those biases don't exist for us, right? So the typical day ends with me with a glass of whiskey in my hand and just thinking through my day. I most likely will still get like personal calls or work calls, but today is a much easier day, calmer day. I think I mentioned earlier that we sort of closed an investor, so things are a bit calmer before I get on the road again. And I'm traveling next week. As I said, we're expanding into Ghana and Nairobi, and I'm going to Accra to get the business running there. Essentially, like, when I'm having like my personal thoughts to myself, I think about the past, like how we've built the business to this point, and sort of what our drivers are, or what my personal drivers are. Would I go back to paid employment? Yes, because I swear it can be easier. But I think building a legacy and building something that people believe in, and something that's actually changing people's lives, right? Changing the narrative of how we live in most of Africa is what drives me. One day my daughter would wake up, and because her father and his colleagues decided that in West Africa, or in most of Africa, we wouldn't pay annual rent anymore, and they decided to solve that problem, it would be normal for her to do that, right? That's what sort of drives me, right? The thought of that type of success, right? Obviously, the monetary success that comes from it is also a valid goal. But for me, that's it. That's why we keep keeping on, right? And then, I mean, personally, I revel in the little things, little wins, because, you know, the losses or the no's can be overwhelming. That's how I typically end my day, thinking about what would happen tomorrow, what I need to do for the rest of the week. And that's how I like to retire, and just because I don't like getting home and having to do work. Occasionally I would, but I don't like it. So I like to power down in the office and then go home and sleep. I feel like we're building the future. And this future for us is now, and it's urgent, right? And to every entrepreneur out there that's building something that feels like they need to give up, it's a hard journey, it's a tough journey, it's tougher than working for somebody else, you know, that's fact. But I think it's rewarding, especially when you're able to build a legacy and change the world, or your world.